is a business radio show where we talk about all the craziness of small business. It's that craziness that actually makes it exciting, interesting, and totally unpredictable. This is Business Insanity Talk Radio with your host, Barry Moltz.
Welcome back. Lee Ellis is the founder and president of Leadership Freedom, LLC. He's a leadership consultant and a keynote speaker talking about hiring, team building, executive development, and succession planning. His extensive background in the development of leadership assessment. Early in his career, Lee served as an Air Force fighter pilot, flying 53 combat missions over North Vietnam. In 1967, he was shot down and held as a POW for more than 5 years in Hanoi and surrounding camps. After the war, he commanded a flying squadron and then managed leadership development before retiring as a colonel. Lee's combat decorations include 2 Silver Stars, the Legion of Merit, the Bronze Star with Valor Device, the Purple Heart, and the POW Medal. He's got a new book called Leading with Honor, Leadership Lessons from the Hanoi Hill. And Lee, welcome to the show.
Good morning, Barry. Good to be with you.
Thanks for being on the show. So you were shot down and captured in Vietnam. Tell us a little bit about, because, you know, most of this generation, I mean, I remember Vietnam, but most of this generation doesn't even remember that war. What was it like and what were the conditions in the camp?
Well, I was captured over enemy territory where we'd been bombing, so that was a pretty scary thing. My airplane blew up and I parachuted out and was captured by the militia there. And over the next 2 weeks, they moved me into Hanoi, which was quite an adventure because I was bombed 3 or 4 times by American airplanes, and they didn't know it was me. They were just trying to stop the enemy trucks from moving. And also there were about 3 times when the local populace found out I was in the village and tried to kill me, which was understandable. You know, we'd been bombing up there. Fortunately,
right.
The young sergeant who was in charge of me moving me forward was a person who led with honor. He had orders to bring pilots in alive and to take me up, and he did a good job. He actually protected me. He and his men protected me on several occasions to make sure that they delivered the goods, so to speak. But the Hanoi Hilton was an old French fortress in downtown Hanoi. It's a block long, a block square, almost square. And it housed a lot of Vietnamese prisoners as well as American prisoners early in the war. And then later in the war, there were more than 400 American POWs, mostly all air crews in the Hanoi Hilton at one time. But they had other camps around Hanoi and even up in the mountains.
Well, you know, today, I mean, I'm 52 years old. The younger generation really can't even really conceive of this. What was it really like for families back home? Because it was horrifying for you. It had to be further horrifying for them.
Yes, you're exactly right, Barry, because they did not know what was happening to us. My family didn't know for sure that I was dead or alive. They knew that I was on the ground alive, but they didn't know if I survived that initial capture or not. And many of the guys' families didn't know for several years. Some of them were married and declared dead. One of my best friends, a couple of them, that was the case. Another one was engaged and declared dead. So it was very difficult. My family found out about a year and a half later for sure that I was alive in the Hanoi Hilton at that time. So it was very tough for them, and they were told initially, don't talk about it because we don't want to, you know, we don't know what the enemy's thinking, so we don't want
right.
to make too much noise about it. And then finally, the wives and families kind of rose up against the administration and said, we've been quiet long enough, and you haven't done anything, so we're going to get loud, and you're going to have to do something. And that's
right
part of the story in the book.
Well, I remember that when I was a teenager, I was wearing one of those POW bracelets and didn't take it off until the gentleman came home. So this is really an extreme situation. What did you really learn about leadership and purpose and organization from this experience?
Yeah, I think the first thing you learn is you learn about yourself, which is one of the most important lessons as a leader or anybody in any role can you know, have that perspective of really knowing yourself, because everything got stripped away up there and you were who you were. You couldn't pretend in that environment, whether you were a leader or a follower or just an individual locked up there. And really getting to know yourself, your strengths, your struggles, the mistakes you'd made, you had plenty of time to reflect back. You had plenty of time to think ahead. For me, I had time to grow up, but I also had time to observe some really strong leadership, some courageous leadership. And because our culture was built around the code of conduct and the honor of military honor of doing your duty, doing the right thing, others before self, because we had that culture, we really saw leading with honor in kind of the extreme and under the best circumstances, even in the worst circumstances. And it was the leaders that suffered the most. And for them to continue to lead and continue to follow the code of conduct and be loyal and take torture to stand up to do the right thing was just very inspiring to me. And I just felt like there were some lessons to be drawn from all of that that we could all learn and use in everyday life.
So give us some of the lessons. Most of the folks that listen to our show are small business owners. What kind of leadership lessons can they learn from you?
Well, one of the first ones, you have to start with your character. So many business leaders get in trouble, and not just business leaders, but the bookkeepers and so on, guarding their character. There's so many temptations to cut corners, and I think you really have to work at guarding your character. You can't just assume you have good character. You have to really commit to it and then work at it. You have to stay positive. You know, you're going to get knocked down, and you have to be resilient and bounce back. If you have a business, you know, you're going to take licks. Things aren't going to work out like you planned. You're going to have to find a plan B. You're going to have to be resilient and bounce back. And the more you do that, the more you realize that that's really what life is all about. It's about bouncing back and being resilient. I really think it's important for leaders to clarify the culture. Our leaders up there certainly did that, and they did it in a simple way, but it was connected to our deepest values and to our mission. And we rallied around our culture, and culture became very important. One of the most important ones for a business person, the more people you hire, the more important your communications are going to be and the more difficult. So chapter 8 in the book is called Overcommunicate the Message. I tell the story of how the POWs had to invent ways of communicating because the enemy was always trying to shut us down and isolate us so we couldn't communicate, we couldn't have a team. And it's the same way in business. You know, you really have to work at communicating to get the word out. Jack Welch says in his book, Straight from the Gut, I had one sermon and I preached it everywhere I went just to try to get the message out.
Right.
So those are some of the ones that jump off the top. Other ones would be develop your people. You have to learn to balance mission and people. You have to get results or you don't stay in business, but you also have to take care of your people. So exploiting creativity. I talk about how the creative ways that we were able to do things to actually have some fun or to, one guy escaped, he was captured again, but he was very creative. But we had some very creative people that really made life a lot better for us. And I think toward the end, I talk about celebrating your trials, and treasuring your trials and celebrating your successes. You have to learn from your failures and learn from the setbacks and then learn how to celebrate.
Well, we have the utmost respect of what you went through. When does the book come out, and where can people get it?
Okay, the book is available in pre-release right now on leadingwithhonor.com, and you can learn more about it. It's also, you can buy it on Amazon and Barnes & Noble. It'll be in the bookstores on the 14th of May. We're having a pre-launch party, the launch party, May the 8th in Washington, D.C. Senator McCain, who wrote the foreword, is coming to speak, and so we'll have a nice event there. But it's available now on leadingwithhonor.com, or you can actually go ahead and order it on the online sources. It'll be in the bookstores the 14th of May.
Lee, thanks for being on the show, and best of luck with the book. Have a good weekend.
Thank you so much, Barry. You too.
Thank
Bye.
You.